1 August 2018, Harare, Zimbabwe. 2 days earlier, Zimbabweans across the country had voted in a general election that was relatively peaceful. But election results are not being released as expected. The electoral body is showing open bias to the ruling party ZANU-PF.
The results that are coming out are as a result of rigging. They must recount those results.
Agitated citizens take to the streets of the capital Harare on the morning of August 1. Singing and displaying placards, the protesters march towards the results center. They are demanding that the electoral body ZEC releases presidential elections results immediately. They have a precedence they do not want repeated. In 2008, the same electoral body had withheld presidential election results for over 4 weeks. Emmerson Mnangagwa, successor to all-time ruler Robert Mugabe, has made lofty promises that 2008 will not be repeated.
No one, no one.
He has a long list of promises to open up democratic space if he wins this watershed election.
Well, initially, in terms of pronouncements and talks by the president Mnangagwa, there were promises that things would improve, that the new dispensation would be respectful of human rights.
So, the protest is happening within what is supposed to be a democratic space, in full view of local and international media and diplomats who had come to cover and observe the polls. But within minutes, the regime's mask will fall and expose the military and despotic nature of the Mnangagwa leadership. As protesters march, army trucks roll into the city center and assume defensive positions. In front of cameras, soldiers open fire on unarmed fleeing citizens, killing 7 and injuring dozens others.
People are being beaten by the soldiers. Some of our guys have been killed.
What follows are brazen acts of arbitrary arrests, abductions, and harassments of citizens, rights activists, and opposition politics actors. Once again, the promise of change after the 2017 coup that ousted Mugabe has all but vanished. Zimbabwe is back onto the path of terror and dictatorship. But the country is not alone in this. This is a growing trend in Southern Africa and beyond. It is characterized by state-sponsored suppression of human rights, by regimes thirsty for control of state power. In the Democratic Republic of the Congo, general elections were originally scheduled for November 2016, but the then president, Joseph Kabila, postponed them by a year to end of 2017. This promise was subsequently broken. It took international and internal pressure, and the elections were finally held in December 2018. Post-election, there were delays in announcing the results and documented attempts to manipulate the electoral process. In Malawi, the democratic space for civil society is also under attack. If left unchallenged, this will impede the gains made by non-state actors since the emergence of Malawi's nascent democracy in 1994. Following the May election, Malawi has experienced politically motivated election violence. Citizens are dissatisfied with the election results management. The European Union and several local NGOs have condemned the elections. Opposition activists who are critical to the government have been under serious attacks and arrests by the state. In Zambia, human rights violation has continued. Some of the incidents include recent death of a female student, Vespas Shimujila. Shimujila died from suffocation by police tear gas. The continuous selective application of the Public Order Act has led to a lot of violations of human and citizens' rights. In South Africa, the scourge of xenophobic attacks continues. The violent attacks emanate from socio-economic challenges South Africans are facing. Political actors preach hate and blame foreign nationals residing in South Africa. Lesotho has been enjoying relative democracy. But there is a new rise in the issues of electoral fraud and manipulation. Democratic space has been shrinking drastically. Parliament, the executive and judiciary are neglecting their responsibilities.
Lesotho has always been in need of the reforms. Everybody has agreed to that. Security reforms, public service reforms, media reforms, governance reforms, constitutional reforms.
Swaziland is still under the rule of the absolute king. He can arbitrarily override any law and enactments made by the legislature. Away from the Southern African continent, movement towards full democratization has continually been affected by human rights abuses. Only recently in Uganda, opposition activist Bobi Wine was charged with annoying the president. With all this background, there is no doubt there is need to claim for strong institutions that protect citizens and not politicians. Since 2017, Southern African governments have been attempting to close the little available democratic space. There is rise of competitive authoritarian regimes.
We have received reports of serious human rights abuses, including beatings, abductions, torture.
Elections were held, but marred with, obviously, violence, voter suppression, etc. That has just heightened. It has heightened the tensions within communities which were already, obviously, tense.
These regimes are moving to enact laws that seek to curtail the operating space of CSOs. Ruling elites are presiding over the death of the promise to democratize the continent. They have taken the lead in criminalizing human rights and development work. The arrest and suppression of dissenting voices in the SADC region calls for robust action by social movements.
So we must address the foundational issues of democracy, economic prosperity, and also to say, how do we build new institutions? How do we have new people?
This is in order to influence SADC as a bloc to make pronouncements that show respect for CSOs and social movements. Social movements and civil society need to unite and escalate solidarity action.